In this video, I will show that the resolution and NDC are two different things. Too often I come across the myth that the resolution is an equivalent of NDC, and people get away with using one without the other. I will demonstrate how an appropriate definition and interpretation of the two helps us to control the quality of our decisions. There is always a risk that the decision will be wrong. If this risk is out of control, you will randomly get rid of the good measuring devices and you will be using the non-capable measuring devices to manage your production. The primary focus shall therefore be to keep this risk under control. Let's see, for example, the gauge R&R. Here is data presented in the MSA, the Measurement System Analysis Manual. The total gauge R&R is a little over 0.3, which makes the measuring device acceptable at 10% gauge R&R for a tolerance of 18.14. In other words, if the tolerance is 18.14 or more, the gauge R&R is okay. The resolution was 0.01, which is 0.06% of the tolerance, way below the criteria of 10%. But the NDC is only 4. Is it a problem? Do we need to change something about the measuring devices? Let's take a step back and see what the resolution and NDC really mean. First, the resolution. It is the smallest change in the quantity being measured that causes a perceptible change in the indication. In other words, the resolution is such a width of a bin on which the measured quantity is no longer continuous and the bin assigns the same value to any part that falls within its width. The theory of measurement uncertainty distinguishes three categories here: the resolution, the resolution of a displaying device, and the discrimination threshold. Here we consider a slightly simplified but quite frequent case when all these can be approximated by the resolution of the displaying device. Imagine the resolution bin as a funnel. The resolution has some notable properties, such as it is not dependent on the measurement uncertainty, it is not dependent on the environment nor other components of the measuring process, and it is not dependent on the measured part. It is solely a property of how the readout of the measuring device was designed. This is important when we want to evaluate the measuring device based on repeated measurements. If the resolution is too big, the estimates of repeatability, reproducibility, and others would be imprecise. In some simplified procedures, like those in the MSA, it is therefore a criterion of applicability of the procedure rather than a measure of the device's quality. Some other procedures don't need this criterion as they account for the resolution as a component of the measurement uncertainty. Just out of interest, this is what the data of the presented example would look like when measured with 5% resolution. Due to rounding, the gauge R&R is now over 13% and the NDC is 3. And with 10% resolution, the gauge R&R is over 18% and the NDC is only 2. The change in the resulting parameters is all due to lowered resolution. The resolution does not only impact the uncertainty of the measuring process, but also the quality of the gauge R&R parameter itself. The NDC parameter, on the other hand, is a bit more complicated. NDC stands for number of distinct categories, meaning that there are in fact some distinguishable bins into which the measuring device is able to sort the measured objects in a repeatable way. These categories are adjacent and the higher the precision of the measuring device, the smaller the categories. The criteria for the category is that when one part is being measured repeatedly, it will always fall in at most two categories. And so, for most measuring devices, the width of the distinct bin is much wider than the width of the resolution bin. Let's think a bit how the width of the distinct bin is estimated. Let's imagine we have infinitely many parts of known dimensions. And this is a purely imaginary concept. Of course, we never know the real dimension. And let's imagine that these parts are measured with a measuring device of a perfect linearity, which means that bias equals zero at all points of the measuring scale, which is also a purely theoretical concept. So the real value of the measured object is deformed only by the random repeatability error. The repeatability error can be produced by any other imaginable effect, like the influence of an appraiser, the environment, the measured part, and so on. And the greater the influence of all these factors, the wider the bin will be. So the bin is really a product of a distribution that is a result of the influences I mentioned. In the MSA, the NDC is calculated as a ratio of the par variation to the gauge RNR times the square root of 2 rounded to 2 decimal places and then truncated to a whole number, and the MSA claims that the number of categories covers the par variation span with 97% probability based on the estimated gauge RNR. The idea is quite sound, and it in fact corresponds to the classification ratio, a parameter that is nowadays almost forgotten. Well, the MSA formula is not exactly correct, but fortunately, the problem is only the constant. The real number of distinct categories would have to have the quantile of the gauge RNR's distribution in the place of the 1.41, which for normal distribution would be something like 1.38 for the claimed 97% probability and the usual 3 sigma of par variation. And there is actually no reason to truncate the number. The NDC calculated per the MSA is very similar and can still be used. We just need to remember that it is a bit higher than the real NDC and account for this when interpreting the result. This seems to be just a little practical joke by the authors of the MSA. There can be different formulas for the NDC depending on how the NDC is defined, and some definitions may include the distribution of the real dimension being measured. By the way, the older versions of the MSA use the tolerance instead of the par variation in the formula, which is an equivalent measure to the percent gauge RNR, just inversely proportional. Since the gauge RNR is now the popular parameter, the NDC in this hands has become obsolete. Let's see how we can read the NDC. It is a measure of how different the parts are that we have used in the gauge RNR experiment. If the parts we choose were almost the same, and their difference would be below what the measuring device was able to distinguish due to repeatability, then we will only have one distinct category. This means that the measuring device is not able to repeatedly tell which part is smaller and which is bigger. This situation can be improved by lowering the repeatability error, but what if the gauge RNR is already adequate for the purpose of our measurement? Then the option is to increase the variation among the parts. The idea is that in order to estimate the gauge RNR with adequate quality, we need to make sure we have sufficiently different parts in the experiment. The NDC parameter is now not a measure of the quality of the measuring device,
but a measure of the quality of our experiment. When the NDC is high, it means we have chosen a set of parts providing adequate variation in the measured quantity needed for a proper gauge R&R estimate. If we look back at our example data and at the tolerance limits, we can clearly see that the parts in the experiment cover only a very small portion of the tolerance. The data indicates that the measuring device was tested only for cases when the production runs notably well, and it was not tested over the needed working range. We generally need the measuring device to function especially when we want to make adjustments to the production process, which is at the control limits or close to the tolerance limits, but certainly not in the middle of the tolerance.
In this case, the low NDC indicated that the experiment was poorly prepared. It is clear we need a more variable set of the 10 parts to properly measure the gauge R&R. Back to the original question. The resolution and NDC are two very different things. The resolution tells us if we can apply the MSA procedures to our measuring devices, while the NDC tells us if we prepare the gauge R&R experiment correctly. The parameters that we in the end use to draw our conclusions must be interpreted in accordance with their definitions. If we choose to change the definition of, for example, the NDC, the interpretation will also be different. If we neglect that, we can easily lose control of the risk associated with our decision, which is something we certainly want to avoid.